start this lecture by talking about the type of difference, and we are going to start with the allocating the difference between the common stock and the preferred stock. As we said before, preferred stock has the priority in receiving dividends before giving anything to the common stock. So in this case, when we talk about carry dividends, we have to give the preferred stock first, and then we'll go to the common stock. And this depends on the type of preferred stock. We said that we have community preferred stock and the participating preferred stock. So in this example, we are talking about the cash difference, and we will see how to allocate the cash difference between common stock and the preferred stock with taking different situations. So in this example, ABC company capital structure include the following: preferred stock 5%, 100,000 par value, and the common stock 200,000 par value. On December 1st, 2007, the company declared 50,000 cash dividends. And we are going to determine how to allocate this 50,000 cash dividends between the preferred stock and the common stock. Let's start with the first situation. The first situation when the preferred stock is non-commutative and non-participating. In this case, the preferred stock should take first the fixed percentage, the specific percentage. We have in this example that preferred stock is 5% preferred stock. 5% means that we have to give the preferred stock 5% of its par value, which is 100,000 times 5% is 5,000. And this will be allocated to the preferred stock first. The whole remaining amount, 45,000, will go to the common stock. This is the first situation and the easy situation when the preferred stock is non-commutative and non-participating. Let's take the second example, second situation, when the preferred stock is commutative and non-participating. And there are 2 years in arrears. 2 years in arrears means that the company didn't declare any dividends last year and the year before. So the preferred stock, because it's cumulative, it should take first the dividends in arrears, which is the right of the preferred stock, because it's cumulative. Cumulative means when the company, if the company failed to pay dividends in any year, it will allocate to the preferred dividends in the next year. So we have 2 years in arrears, means that we have for preferred stock 2 years, last year and last year before, so it will take $10,000, 5,000 times 2, $10,000. This is the difference in arrears. And the current dividends is 5,000. So the amount allocated to the preferred stock is 15,000, and the remaining 35,000 will go to the preferred stock, to the common stock. So the preferred stock will take 15,000, 10,000 plus 5, and the remaining amount of the 50,000 will go, the remainder will go to the common stock. The third situation, when the preferred stock is non-commutative and participating. Non-commutative and participating. Participating means that we have to give the common stock and the preferred stock the same percentage, even over the fixed rate for the preferred stock. Preferred stock in this case has 5%, so we will start with the difference to preferred stock 5,000, which is the 5%, and we will give the common stock the same percentage. 200,000 per barrel times 5% is 10,000. So the amount allocated 15,000. The remaining amount with the 35,000 will be allocated between the preferred stock and the common stock by the relative percentage of the per barrel. So we have to divide the 35,000, the remaining amount, over 300,000, the total per barrel, 100 plus 200. So the percentage is 11.67. So the preferred stock will take 11.670, which is the 11.6 times 100,000 per value. And the common stock will take 200,000 times 11.67, which is the 23,330. So the remaining amount will be allocated between common stock and the preferred stock by this amount. So the total allocated amount to preferred stock is 16,670 for preferred, and 33,330 for the common stock. The fourth situation, the fourth case, when the preferred stock is cumulative and participated, and there are 2 years in arrears. So we have 2 years in arrears. We have to start with the 2 years in arrears. Mean that the preferred stock will take 10,000. And the current dividend to preferred will be 5,000. And the participated to the common stock will take the same percentage, 5%, 10,000. So the total amount is 15,000. The remaining amount, 25,000, will be allocated to the preferred and the common by the relative percentage of par value. So we have to divide 25,000 over 300,000. So the percentage will be 8.33 times the par value for every class of stock. So the common stock will take 16,670. Preferred stock will take 8,330. So the total amount is 25,000, and the common stock will take 26,670 as a total. Preferred stock will take 23,330 as a total. Sometime we determine maximum participation for the preferred stock. So in this case number five, the preferred stock is cumulative and participated by maximum 10% to preferred stock, and there are 2 years in arrears. So in this case, we have to give the preferred stock 10,000, which is the difference in arrears. The first, we have to start with the difference in arrears. And then the current year dividend for common preferred stock, 5% of the par value, 5% is 5,000. 5% for common stock, 200,000 to 10,000. At this stage, we have to make a test. If the preferred stock will take more than 10% as a total, we have to give the remaining 5% in order to be 10%. So in this case, the remainder would be 5,000, which is the 5%. 5% plus 5% is 10% is the maximum participation, and all the remaining will go to the common stock. This is the five situations which explain how to allocate the cash dividends between preferred stock and the common stock depending on the characteristics of the preferred stock. Now we have to talk about how to prepare the entries. How to prepare the entries for cash dividends and the different type of dividends. We will start with the cash dividends. On March 10, 2017, the company declared cash dividends for 200,000. In March 20, 2007, the company paid the dividends. So in this case, as we said before, all dividends would be taken from the retained earning, because the retained earning is the inventory of Jebel. It's the inventory of Jebel. And we said that retained earning, beginning balance of the retained earning will be increased by the net income and would decrease by any type of dividends. So the beginning balance of retained earning plus net income for the period minus dividends, any kind of dividends, will bring the ending balance for the retained earnings. So in this case, the company declared 200,000 cash dividends, and in March 20, the company paid the dividends. So we have to start with the event of declaring dividends. So we said, debit retained earning, credit dividend payable, 200,000. When we pay the dividends, actually pay the dividends, we have to say, dividend payable, credit cash, 200,000. This is the case of cash dividends. Now we talk about the property dividend. What is the meaning of property dividend in situation when the company achieved the profit, but the company doesn't have cash? So the company can make any distribution for assets, maybe inventory, maybe investments in another stock for another company. So in this case, we have the company transfer to stockholder some of its investments in marketable securities, costing 1,250,000 by declaring property dividends on December 30, 2017. And it took be distributed on January 30, 2018 to stockholders. At the date of declaration, the securities have a market value of 2 million. The general rule for property dividends is to recognize any gain or loss at the time of the declaration of property dividends as if the company sold this inventory on investment. So in this case, we allocate marketable securities, which is the cost of 1,250,000. The market value is 2 million, so we recognize gain for 757. This is the beginning of the property dividend. It's to start with the recognition of gain or loss for the property that the company will allocate. So in this case, we have gain of 757. We say debit investments and securities, credit gain and investments. Now, we have to allocate the property dividend by declaring property dividends. We'll take the market value for this investment. We say debit retained earnings, credit property dividends payable. When we allocate the investments actually to the stockholder, we say debit property dividends payable, credit investments in securities. This is the property dividend. So the general rule for the property dividends is to recognize the gain or loss at the time of declaration of property dividends, and then we take the market value for the assets allocated, inventory, investment, whatever, and we will take this amount, the market value, from the retained earnings. We say retained earnings, credit property dividend payable. When we allocate, actually, we say property dividend payable, credit the property, which is the investments and securities in this case. The third type of dividends is the stock dividends. And we have to notice that cash dividends and the property dividends, both of them will lead to decrease in the assets and the decrease in the total stockholder equity of the company, of the corporation. But the stock dividends is considered capitalization of retained earnings to be paid in capital. We know before what is the difference between the paid in capital and the retained earnings. Retained earnings is the earned capital. Capital that the company achieved by self-operation, by its self-operation inside the corporation. But the paid in capital, the contribution of stockholders in the investments or the capital of the corporation. So in the stock difference, we don't allocate assets. So the assets would be the same. Stockholder would be the same. But the reclassification of the stockholder will be capitalized, capitalization of retained earning to be paid in capital. Let's start with explaining this item. We say stock dividends differ from cash dividends. Cash dividends represent the distribution of cash which lead to a decrease in assets and a decrease in retained earning by equal amount. Stock dividends, on the other hand, represent the transfer of retained earning, which is the earned capital, into paid in capital without any effect on total assets or total stockholder equity. This is the difference between the stock dividends and any other dividend, cash dividends or property dividends. Cash dividends and the property dividends will decrease the assets and decrease the stockholder equity. However, stock dividends is not going to affect any assets or any stockholder equity, but its reallocation of the item inside the stockholder equity will be transferred the retained earning into paid income. This is very important situation and a very important point to notice. Now we have to differentiate between two types of stock dividends. If the stock dividends is less than 20%, we call it small stock dividends. If the stock dividends is higher than 25%, 25% of the issued stocks, in this case we call it large stock dividends. What is the difference between small stock dividends and the large stock dividends? The accounting standard says that if we have small stock dividends, less than 20%, 10%, 15%, we have to account for this stock dividends by its market value, by the market value of the stock at the date of declaration, at the date of declaration. However, when we have large stock dividends, 25% or more, 25% of the number of, how to determine the percentage, I will explain after a while. Large stock dividends, we have to account for the large stock dividends by the par value for stock, not by the market value, but by the par value of stock. Let's explain this by examples. Now, the first example. This is the capital structure for a QA corporation. Common stock, 10⅓ shares authorized. And we explained before what is the meaning of authorized, the maximum number of shares that the company can issue. 8,000 shares issued and outstanding. And we said before that issued is the number of shares the company issue actually. Outstanding is the number of shares that traded in the market. They will be different when we have treasury stock. I explained this before in the previous literature. So in this case, we have common stock, 10,000 shares authorized, the maximum number of shares that the company can issue. The company issued actually 8,000 shares issued and outstanding. In par value for the stock is $10, so the capital, the paid in capital is 80,000. The additional paid in capital for common stock, 200,000. The retained earning is 150,000. The company in January 10, 2018 declared 800 common shares stock dividends. So in this case, if we divide 800 shares, the stock dividends 800 over the total number of shares issued at the outstanding, 8,000. So the percentage is 10%. So in this case, it's a small stock dividend. If the stock dividend is a small stock dividend, 20% or less, we have to account for this stock dividend by its market value. What is the market value for share at the time of declaration? At the time of declaration, in the exam, when I give you the market value at the declaration date, at the allocation date for the stock, we have to take the market value for stock at the declaration date, which is the $15 per share. So in this case, we have to account for the 800 times 15, which is the 20,000 will be taken from retained earnings. So I will say debit retained earnings, credit the part value for the 800, which is 8,000, 800 times 10, 8,000. The remaining will go to the additional paid in capital for such. So in case of a small stock difference, 10% or less, and we make tests to determine if the stock dividend is small or large by dividing the number of shares issued for stock dividends over the total number of shares issued and outstanding. If it's less than 20%, we have to multiply this number of shares to multiply by the market value per share. And this amount will be taken from retained earnings. We will take the par value for common stock as common stock dividend distributable, because we didn't distribute it actually. Common stock dividend distributable, and the remaining will be additional pay in capital. When we distribute actually the stock dividends, we say debit common stock dividend distributable, credit common stock. This is when we have a small stock dividend. What is the case if we have large stock dividends? If we have large stock dividends, in January 10th, the company declared 2,400 common shares, stock dividends. 2,400 over 8,000 means 30%. 30% is large stock dividend. So we have to account for this stock difference by its market, by its par value, not market value, par value. 24 times 10, this is the amount will be taken from retained earnings. So debit retained earnings, 24,000, credit common stock dividend distributable. And then when we allocate it, actually we say common stock dividend distributable, credit common stock by the same amount. Let's talk about the last point in this chapter, which is the stock split. What is the meaning of stock split? The meaning of stock split, when the company, when the market value per share increased considerably, this will discourage the small investor to buy and invest in this company, in this the stock of this company, because the market value is very high. If we have, for example, $1 million and the market value per share is 1,000, we will buy just 1,000 share. But if the market value per share is 100, we have to, buy 10,000 shares. So this is the difference between the small market value and the large. So in this case, in order to encourage the small investor to buy the stock of the company, we have to make stock split. So the stock split, when the market value per share increased considerably, the company may decide to make a stock split to increase the number of shares and reduce the par value per share. So in this case, if we make split 2-for-1, 2-for-1 means that every stock, common stock, will be divided into two stock. If I am investor in a corporation and I have 10,000 shares, common stock, if the company made stock split 2-for-1, This means that the 10,000 shares I have will be converted into 200,000 shares by multiplying the number of shares, which is 100,000 shares times the split factor, which is the 2. If the split factor is 3-for-1, means that the 100,000 I have will be converted into 300,000. 100 times 3 is 300,000. And the par value will be divided by the split factor. So the capital amount will be the same. Let's explain it by this example. Before the stock split, the company had common stock, 10,000 shares issued and outstanding. The par value is 10. So the capital account amount is 100,000. After stock split 2-for-1, we have to multiply the 10,000 times 10, 2, which is the split factor, so we have 20,000 shares. 10,000 will be converted into 20,000. And the par value 10 will be divided by 2, it will be par value of 5. And the capital amount is 100,000. So when the company made stock split, the only effect on the stockholder equity, just disclosure, it doesn't need any entries. It will just affect the number of shares issued and the par value per share. The remaining numbers will be the same. So in this case, if we have stock split 3-for-1, we multiply the number of shares we have times 3 and divide the par value over 3. 2-for-1, multiply the number of shares we have times 2 and divide the par value over 2. In this case, the stock split, after this stock split, after this transaction, the market value per share will go lower, and this will encourage the small investor to buy and invest in the stock of this company. By this example, we finished the first lecture. Let's start next time with the chapter about the earning per share. We finish this lecture and we'll start next time with the talking about the earning per share.